What I watched in May, let's get into it. I started the month with watching The Fall Guy. And this is how you make a movie about making a movie. In all seriousness, this film doesn't take itself too serious, which makes the film better. I enjoyed the whole film and felt like the chemistry between Gosling and Blunt was fully there, and that this film was funny and a lot of the action was really good. I like the idea of them struggling to make a movie within a movie, and then the stuff happening in the film being mutually beneficial for the plot and the making of the film. This film could have easily gotten lost in translation, but I thought the third act was electric, and this film was overall just super fun. Then I watched The Phantom Menace in theaters, and was getting to experience this film in theaters cool? No, not really. I think if theaters made it more limited, like a one day, one showtime run, it would have been cooler, but my theater was just empty with one family that decided to talk the entire time, and the mom and the kids were just asking questions the entire time. I would have said something or cared, but it's the Phantom Menace, so who gives a shit? Then I watched Rise of the Planet of the Apes, and this is the weakest one of the trilogy, but I can't really knock it at all. I still really enjoy it, and in terms of an origin slash first film into a new universe, it more than does the job. Then I rewatched Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, and this is just fantastic. Matt Reeves was such a good hire. He creates such a world with so much emotion and empathy, and Caesar just is one of the best written characters of all time. Then I got to rewatch War of the Planet of the Apes, and I love this film so much. The only thing I don't like is that this film is called War. Not that it even affects my viewing at all, but it builds this false expectation to many viewers. When this film came out, they were going to watch this action-packed finale, which didn't allow them to view this film for the beauty it is because they were expecting something else. What we get here is one of the best cinematic finishes to any trilogy. This film is a masterpiece in every meaning of the word. The cinematography is otherworldly. The music and score constantly builds and adds emotion. Every character adds so much to the story, and this film may not be fast-paced, but it constantly builds and moves you emotionally to where you feel the stakes, and even when dumb decisions are made, you understand why the character did that. New characters are added, and they add so much to an expansive world without taking away from what's already been built. The war is for the apes' lives and for their future. Then I watched Love Lies Bleeding, and this is a very untraditional love story, but I quite enjoyed it. It had a great performances and it had a great soundtrack. Then I watched The Idea of You, the straight to streaming Anne Hathaway film. This was a very unneeded rom-com, which means it came with all the cliches. But at the same time, it isn't a hard watch. You can just put yourself in a mindset to like this movie and you can enjoy it. But you don't have to do that, and it can seem very bad. So whichever way you want to go into it is up to you. Then I watched Godzilla and Kong, The New Empire. It's very hard to like a movie like this after getting Godzilla Minus One last year. Like, sure, the human character plot is decent, definitely better than it was in King of Monsters, but you can tell the writers were just using so much filler to get to the big final battle to happen. And I just wasn't that impressed. Even though this one has more action, it just still left me missing movies like the original Godzilla or Godzilla Minus One. Like, it's capable of happening. You can make a good movie like that, but not in an expansive universe. Then I watched the 2001 Planet of the Apes with Mark Wahlberg, and I bet the studio was so excited to release a Tim Burton Planet of the Apes reboot, but it just didn't feel very fleshed out. It felt rushed and unmotivated and just ended up being very bleh. Then I watched Kingdom of the Planet of the Apes, and similar to Rise, this one has a lot of world building, which can be mesmerizing, but at times you also wish the pace would pick up a little bit and be a little faster. I just wish it was a little shorter, but it's beautiful to look at and it introduces great characters and excites me for the future because after War came out, I didn't want another Planet of the Apes movie. I thought it ended perfectly. But at least this one adds rather than takes away anything from those movies. Then I watched Boogie Nights, and that had been on my watch list for probably 7 years. I'm embarrassed to admit the amount of Paul Thomas Anderson films I've actually seen, but I really enjoyed this, and I can see why so many people love it. Then I watched Close, and this film fucked me up. I was not prepared emotionally. The two leads in this have had no acting experience prior, and I was just amazed by the amount of promotion provoked from them in this film. It just grabs you by the heart and makes you try to cry like a baby. Then I watched the Transformers 40th anniversary. This was the first four episodes of the TV show released in theaters. And it was cool to see in theaters, probably the nerdiest screening I've ever been to. But I think they only should have played the first three episodes because it is a three-parter. And the fourth episode just added on more, but didn't really feel necessary. Then I watched The Strangers Chapter One. I tried posting a 5-minute video of this movie. It just kept getting copyright, so I had to take it down. But just know this film is bad, and the characters have an IQ of a rock. Like, they're dumb. And I'm done thinking about it. I'm done talking about it because I've talked so much about it. No one's heard it because YouTube didn't let me post it. But it's whatever. Let's move on. Then I watched If, and I was ready to trust Krasinski, but this film didn't feel very fleshed out. I felt like it didn't know if it wanted to be a serious kids movie or like a goofy adult film, and it just wasn't balancing the best. I think Krasinski has well intentions, and every film he makes is kind of about family, but it left more to be desired. It wasn't bad, but it left more to be desired. Then I watched Amelie, and this is one of those Wes Anderson films that aren't directed by Wes Anderson, and that means I loved it. This is the type of direction I love. It's such a charming story with a beautiful scenery and amazing direction. Then I watched Mad Max, and I don't care how much our dads hype up this movie, it's not all that. I know it's just the start of something bigger, but I really don't care for the whole trilogy, and this is just one that takes too long to get where it needs to go, even though it's a short runtime. Then I started watching Abbott Elementary, and I watched season one this month. Me and my girl started watching this show, and after the first season, I was happy. I think it's a got good characters and funny scenes. Nothing groundbreaking to the work sitcom genre, but it's a different setting that I enjoy being a part of. Then I watched Amy, the A24 documentary, and I don't watch many documentaries, but this is one of the better ones I have seen. It's so sad to see the spiral, especially with how she had moments of being sober, but drugs can make a lot of things fun, and when you get so hooked on them, especially some of the very addictive ones that she was taking, reality can just seem like it's not enough sometimes, and unfortunately for her, that's kind of what ended up happening. Then I watched Columbus, and I mentioned in my What I Watched in April video, a movie like Peanut Butter Falcon are like the blueprint of films that I love and that I think about of why I love movies so much, and they just connect to me on such a personal level. And the same can be said for Columbus. There's something about feeling lost as an adult, and it feels like you should have figured it all out. But at the same time, it feels like there's plenty of time to figure it out. How you feel like you're the only a little bit behind, but at the same time, every day keeps passing with no progress towards what you actually want to do. This film is one I relate to all too well. Every shot is stunning, it makes the most simple scenery feel so important. Not to mention the dialogue, which feels so smart and real at the same time, adding another layer to this film. I just loved it. Then I rewatched Mad Max Fury Road, and this is how you make a Mad Max film. This is just one of the best action films ever made. There are things we witness in this film that no other film can or will do. It's just pure fucking insanity for 2 hours, and I eat up every second of it. Then I watched Furiosa. I find it impressive that George Miller was able to make a Mad Max trilogy in the 80s that people loved, and then Fury Road and Furiosa for this generation. Even though I don't like the 80s trilogy, I absolutely love Fury Road and Furiosa. It's not better than Fury Road, but it's still fucking great. This film is long, but it doesn't feel like it drags. Everything feels important and moves along the plot. And we get some crazy action and chase scenes in this one as well. Then I watched The Prestige, and I closed out the month very strong, with my last six films being at least 4.5 or 5 stars. Half of those were rewatches, but the other half were new films. And this was my third viewing of The Prestige, and I still feel this is one of Nolan's most slept-on films. I know it gets his love and praise, but I feel like it doesn't get talked about the same way that Inception, Interstellar, or even The Dark Knight do. And I just feel it's as good as those films. Then I rewatched 500 Days of Summer, and I will admit this took three viewings to fully love this film, and this was my fourth watch. But once you watch it through the right perspective, it completely changes your viewing experience. The first viewing is through Tom's eyes, and then Summer's, and then by the third, you can see this movie for what it is, which is a tragic story about how two people can have two different ideas of what love is, and how one can think everything's great, and the other can think the opposite. Summer isn't the villain, she was clear with intent from the beginning. She has her faults, but so does Tom. He thinks he can change Summer and has an unrealistic fascination with love, tries to force this idea onto every partner. The truth is, they just weren't meant for each other, and the signs were there from the beginning. The film just perfectly captures a relationship, the ups and downs, how one may think about only the good times while the other partner may only replay the bad times in their head. I'm thinking about doing a full video on this film because I don't have enough time in this video, but I just love this film, and Expectations versus Reality is one of my favorite scenes in all of cinema. Then I watched Whippet, and I was absolutely surprised by this film. It has maybe the most random collection of a cast I've ever seen, but it stars Elliot Page playing a misfit teen who discovers a roller derby league in nearby Austin, Texas, and she finds a lot of comfort in this as she joins the team and becomes quite good at it. But this film has everything. It just is in more of an untraditional way. A fun sports team being a rough roller derby team with a teenager, but also has Kristen Wiig and Drew Barrymore as adults and other adults. Then it has Jimmy Fallon as the announcer for the games, which was hilarious the entire time. And Elliot Page having a misunderstood but loving relationship with her family, like in Juno. And a relationship between two misfit weirdos in this film as a love story also gave me what I wanted. This film just had everything I wanted, and I was all there for it.